are living in an age of high-tech industrialization, where all material comfort can be acquired through a mere click of the mouse. Thanks to economic liberalization and the crumbling walls of protectionist policies of governments, the world has shrunk. This has been achieved through advanced means of communication, like the internet, and also by pursuing policies of integration with the international community, which has very aptly been named as globalization. In the field of scientific research and development also, the progress has been phenomenal. New drugs have been formulated. Diseases earlier considered incurable can now be treated, and some have altogether been eradicated.
But all this has not been achieved free of cost. As we know, there is always a flip side of the coin, and the bane of all the advancement that mankind has made in numerous fields has been the irreparable loss caused to the environment due to pollution. Pollutants in the form of gases, smoke, liquid and solid matter are being generated in millions of tons round the clock, which is damaging the atmosphere, causing global warming, toxic topsoil and polluted waters.
One such source of potential threat to the environment, and indeed to our very existence, is biomedical waste. Biomedical waste is generated primarily during the diagnosis, treatment, or immunization of human beings or animals from healthcare establishments, and also institutions such as blood banks, laboratories, pharmaceutical industries and research institutes. Have you ever wondered where the pathological waste, radioactive waste, chemical waste and pharmaceutical waste goes or is disposed of by these institutions? We just get admitted into these institutions for our treatment or investigations, avail of the facilities, and get discharged without knowing the fact as to how harmful and infectious these biomedical wastes can be if not properly disposed of. After forming a vague picture of biomedical waste and what it is about, it is necessary to have an idea about the Biomedical Waste Management and Handling Rules 1998 and 2000.
Ministry of Environment and Forest, Government of India formulated the Biomedical Waste Management and Handling Rules in the year 1998. Thereafter, it has been amended in the year 2000. And as per the rules, they have made five schedules, and one has to take care of all the schedules while treating the biomedical waste.
These rules apply to all persons who generate, collect, receive, store, transport, treat, dispose of, or handle biomedical waste in any form.
Under the Environmental Protection Act 1986, whoever do not comply with the provision of these rules can be fined up to rupees 1 lakh or a imprisonment of 5 years or a penalty of rupees 5000 rupees per day for the duration of non-compliance, and all these three can be put in together also.
After listening to these laws and the various nitty-gritties that are involved in the management of biomedical waste, one can realize how serious the matter is. Now, the question which arises as a natural consequence of all these discussions is whether all these laws, norms, and protocols which have been regulated are being adhered to or not. Because simply formulating laws without ensuring that they are being complied with is not going to solve our problem, which has far-reaching consequences.
Biomedical waste management is a special case for management of waste, which is hazardous not just for the generators and operators, but also for the general community. Another important group affected by biomedical waste are the rag pickers, who are not able to distinguish the general waste from biomedical waste.
90% of the waste, biomedical waste, which is generated in India is disposed with the municipal waste. It is going to the trenching grounds. It is containing bacteria, it is containing pathogens, and it is multiplying there, and it is coming back to our society.
Unless sufficient care is taken to neutralize the toxicity and make the waste productive, communicable diseases are likely to spread, especially in an urban environment where the density of population is high. So, it is mandatory for us to understand the different levels through which the biomedical waste passes and what precautions are needed at each of these levels.
Segregation is the success for any disposal of waste, and in the Gazette notification it is clearly mentioned that segregation should be done at source by the institutions, by the hospitals, nursing homes or the clinics.
Different categories of segregated waste need to be collected in color-coded containers as prescribed in the Biomedical Waste Management and Handling Rules 2000.
Segregation on the part of incinerable and non-incinerable waste, like all the incinerable waste which contains the blood-soaked parts, gauze pieces, cottons, that are to be segregated in yellow bags or red bags, and plastic, glass, metal, sharps are to be segregated separately so that they are having different principle of treatment, and it is easy for a common biomedical waste facility operator to treat this waste at site.
Sharp objects must always be kept in puncture-proof containers to avoid injuries to the workers handling them, as any cut in the skin of a handler provides a direct route for pathogens to enter the blood. Plastic bags for storing the waste must be placed inside a container, and a lid should be provided to cover the opening of the bag. The storage time for each category of waste generated should be determined. Wastes such as placenta, which cannot be stored for long durations, should be collected early. Ideally, waste should be collected at least twice a day. And above all, handlers or staff members should be equipped with protective clothing such as goggles, masks, boots, aprons, and gloves to manage these activities. Some pre-treatment should be carried out at the point of waste generation. Syringes and needles should be crushed before putting them into the containers so that rag pickers are discouraged from collecting them for resale. This also saves the needles from getting recycled at a later stage. Sharp objects should be disinfected at source using chemical disinfectants. Laboratory waste and highly infectious waste such as body parts with gangrene or HIV-infected blood should be pre-treated and disposed of immediately.
Medicines which are used in the operation theatres and the discarded medicines and the expiry medicines, all these medicines, they should be collected in the separate containers, and these medicines should not be mixed with any other waste which is generated either in the hospital ward or in the labor rooms or any other department. These medicines, they should be collected separately and they should be disposed of separately. They should not be mixed with the anatomical waste or the operation waste or the infectious waste.
internal transportation of toxic waste and non-toxic waste is an important aspect and must be considered very seriously. This is to be done properly in labeled trolleys or boxed carts. The segregated waste should always be collected and transported separately. Mixing the segregated waste should be strictly prohibited, and special care must be taken for the routine cleaning and disinfecting of these trolleys to minimize the spread of infections. The waste which is transported to the collection point, ready to be transported elsewhere, must also undergo treatment. This stage of biomedical waste management is called post-treatment. At this stage, a particular segregated waste is given suitable disposal treatment before being finally disposed of. For instance, segregated waste which is to be sent to the common incinerator plant should be first dipped in hypochlorine solution before it is kept in transporting vehicles. Let us see what are the various common methods used for disposal of different segregated waste. For example, needle cutters and syringe crushers are used to destroy the syringe and other sharp objects used in various centers. Shredders are used to destroy plastic and paper waste to prevent their reuse. Historically, incinerators have been the most common method used by healthcare facilities in India and are appropriate for pathological waste, anatomical and non-anatomical biomedical waste. An incinerator carries out complete combustion of carbon containing compounds in the presence of fuel and air. The fuel provides heat energy to attain incineration temperature, and air provides oxygen for combustion. The key parameter in an incinerator is the combustion chamber temperature, which should be maintained at around 1200 degrees centigrade, and if the requisite temperature is not ensured, incomplete combustion can result in formation of gases such as dioxins and furans, which are much more detrimental than the initial waste. Incineration is effective when the waste is combustible, because it is a process where the combustible waste is reduced to exhaust gaseous products and to ash, which is acceptable at the local municipal waste site.
The incinerator ash comes under the hazardous category, and it should be disposed of in a secured landfill. If secured landfill is not available in the city, then common biomedical waste treatment facilitator has to develop his own secured landfill for disposal of ash. New technologies are coming in for the disposal of waste, and nowadays autoclave is being used at many places for disposal of biomedical waste.
The autoclave process is an appropriate technology for the treatment of microbiology laboratory waste, human blood and body fluid waste, waste sharp objects, and non-anatomical waste. The hydroclave is an innovative combination of waste sterilization which is similar to autoclave waste fragmentation and dehydration. Microwave disinfections technology is relatively advanced and the latest in the field of medical waste management. The process uses microwave radiation to heat and destroy microorganisms.
Microwave, when installed in India, was not successful because the proper segregation of waste was not there, and the metal parts coming in with the biomedical waste, they damaged the machine. But in Western countries where segregation is being done properly, microwave has been a very useful equipment.
The generators and operators of biomedical waste often face the problem of selecting the right technology for treatment and disposal, and also no single technology is ideal for all kinds of biomedical waste and all scales of operation. In some situation, it may be advantageous to use more than one treatment or technology for the waste generated in an institution. Special care should be taken at the time of external transportation so that biomedical waste is not mixed up with other waste, and no untreated biomedical waste is kept or stored beyond a period of 48 hours. And if a container is to be transported from the premises where biomedical waste is generated to any common treatment facility, then these containers should be kept labeled and away from other containers. And this untreated biomedical waste should be transported only in such vehicles as may be authorized for such purposes. The municipal body of the area should continue to pick up and transport segregated non-biomedical waste generated in any institute, as well as duly treated biomedical waste for being transported to the municipal dump site.
In the final disposal stage, care should be taken to reduce the waste as much as possible, because only a small portion of the biomedical waste is infectious, and the remaining portion, that is, the general waste, can be recycled and converted into manure if properly treated. Only the hazardous substance, such as treated ash from the incinerators, must be disposed of after retrieving the recyclable portion.
Now, by and large, everybody talks about the solid waste, and more often we forget about the liquid waste. For example, maybe any patient coming to a hospital, he may be HIV positive, he may be suffering from hepatitis B. We don't know by looking at the patient. And if you collect the sample of the person, that sample is going to have the viruses for that particular disease. Same way, the hospital with the liquid waste, the effluent is likely to have a large number of bacteria which will be pathogenic. It will also have the viruses, and if these are transported through the sewage to the community, they will be really a great hazard for the community.
The liquid waste should also be dichlorinated before letting it into septic tank. Or if possible, a proper effluent treatment plant should be installed in the concerned institution, as it not only prevents the spread of waterborne diseases like dengue, diarrhea, but also treats the water which can be used for cleaning and gardening.
Every hospital and such institution has to treat the water which will be saved. The question comes that how many hospitals will be having such facility? That's true. But more and more hospitals now should try to use up such systems, so the water that they are going to put it in the municipal sewer system is going to be pure, safe, and again it can be used for the other purpose.
The sludge dried by sunlight can act as a source of good manure too, if the sludge parameters are well within the prescribed limits. After equipping you with the information about biomedical waste management, there is a great need to understand the fact that the role of nurses and paramedical staff is pivotal in managing it. Therefore, education and training of nurses becomes one of the primary steps in managing biomedical waste.
We have taken things into consideration like, first of all, we have prepared some posters which indicates what color coding we are going to carry out, plus in those color codings, what things are to be disposed. So we have prepared the posters in a language which are easily understood by a staff, housekeeping staff, because they are the main workers who are dealing with this waste. Plus, even if some workers are not able to read these posters, then we have picturized those posters in a way that if a yellow container has been shown, then we have shown human body organs. So that even if a housekeeping worker doesn't understand, he cannot read the language, he will understand what to throw in that dustbin.
So every institution should conduct regular in-service education programs for nurses and healthcare workers to keep them abreast of the new trends in infection control and managing waste.
The management of biomedical waste is still in its infancy all over the world. There is a lot of confusion in the minds of the generator community, which may be due to many reasons. The reasons may be lack of awareness, practical difficulties, lackadaisical attitude in adhering to the laid down norms and regulations, or simply a general callousness by all concerned. Now, there is no single magic formula which can solve this problem. The resolution has to be by a shared responsibility by all of us. Firstly, by the generator community, who must realize the deadly consequences that can be inflicted on the society if the waste that are being generated are not disposed of properly. Secondly, by the law enforcing agencies, who are responsible for ensuring that all laid down laws, norms and protocols are being properly adhered to, and if they are not, the wrongdoers are punished. And last but not the least, people like you and me, the users of these facilities which are generating these wastes. Only when a joint effort by all of us concerned is made, only then we can hope for a cleaner environment and a better earth for people like us and our future generations to live in. And since a beginning has to be made someday, why shouldn't we start today itself?